And so tonight, we're going to continue this. Last week, we got our introduction for Baptist distinctives. And those are the things that make us distinctly Baptist. There are things that make us Christians. There are things that make us Bible-believing Christians. There are things that make us born-again Christians. So these are all terms that the world or others might use to describe us. But here at Harmony Baptist Church, we claim the name Baptist, and there's some reasons for that. And so if you take the word Baptists and make it an acrostic, each of those can be used to describe one of the different distinctives that make us Baptists. And so starting with B tonight, we're going to begin with Bible authority. Biblical authority is important. And we as Baptists, we hold that the Bible is the final authority, not just the authority, but the final authority in all matters of faith and practice. And we believe that the Bible is inspired and infallible and is the final authority. It is from God's Word that we understand and teach the fundamental doctrines of our faith, as well as pattern our church policy. And so there's a reason why we hold so closely to the Bible. And the reason that we hold so closely to it is because God holds very closely to it. And we're going to cover both of those things tonight. But it's easy for us on this side of that argument to understand that if we're that serious about the Bible, then it makes sense we would be that serious about what version of the Bible we would use. It makes sense that we would be very, very adamant that we get it right. If the Bible has that much authority, if the Bible has that much say in our life, not just doctrinally, but practically, then we need to make sure that what we're reading is correct. And once we have that conviction, then the way that we interact with the Word of God is going to dictate how well we live the Christian life, really. And so tonight, we're going to take a look at Bible authority. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful for your goodness to us. We're thankful for the Word of God that is in our laps, in our language, easily understood, easily obtainable. And Lord, just that it there is no one that needs to interpret it for us. There is no one that needs to read it for us or present it to us. Lord, each of us has probably multiple copies. Even maybe here with us tonight, Lord, or at home or stashed away somewhere. Lord, we've been blessed with the relationship we have with the Word of God. But Lord, help us tonight to take a look at the principles upon which we stand, Lord, maybe to solidify some things or maybe to help us with some arguments or discussions with others who might ask us of the hope that is within us with fear and trembling. I pray you'd help us, Lord, as we talk about and preach through who we are, Lord, that we would be more solidified in it, and God, that we would be Lord, happy to serve you in spirit and in truth. I pray you'd be with us, be with the kids downstairs, all those that are tuned in, Lord, and the many needs of the people, both physical and spiritual tonight. I pray that you'd meet each one and that you would raise us up, and Lord, that we might be encouraged by you tonight and in the days ahead. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As Baptists, we believe that the Bible is the sole and ultimate authority for Christian faith and practice. Everything we believe doctrinally comes out of this book. Everything that we preach practically comes out of this book. On several of our periodicals and things that we hand out, I don't know exactly, we might not have it the same in each one, but old-fashioned Bible preaching, that's the goal. And I'm careful about that. I'm careful who steps behind the pulpit and what comes across it, because it's important to me that this be the focus. I was in a meeting one time, and the theme of the message and the theme of this I believe it was Pastor's Fellowship, was we need to make sure we keep the main thing the main thing. And the Word of God needs to be number one above everything else. And so that's why it starts. The letter B, first thing, if you're a Baptist, you say, what does that mean? At least the way that we believe it and preach it around here. Number one is Bible authority. And the Bible's going to take precedence over everything else. This book is not simply a guidebook or a suggestion. It's the very Word of God. And as such, we don't treat it haphazardly. And we could go 100 different directions with Bible doctrine and talk about it. I'll say this much to begin. There are folks that ask, you know, do you read the Bible literally? Do you take it literally? Everything that it says, do you read it literally? And I think the best answer to that question is I take the Bible seriously. I take it as God's Word. There's some things in it that he wrote that are very much pictures and types and metaphors. There are some other things that he wrote that are very clear, black and white. He said it, and that's it. There are some other things he wrote and others wrote. And I was talking to my wife about this yesterday. We get, stories in the Bible, accounts in the Bible where We read about in one place Jesus feeds this many people and he uses this many bread and fish and they take up this many baskets afterwards. And then we read another account and he feeds this many people and he uses this many bread and fish and there's this many baskets left over when they're done. And folks like to point to those and say, well, there's discrepancies in the Bible. And to that, the logical answer is, well, one of two things happened. Either one, two people got the wrong details about a story. All right? Or Jesus did it twice. I don't have a problem with either one of those. Because if somebody came to me and described a car accident that happened outside here, and then another person came and described the same car accident, you think their stories are going to be exactly the same? No, of course not. You said, but this is the Word of God. Yes. And so then the point is that the information, now pay close attention, is not near as important as the reason the information's there. What both of those two people testified to was that Jesus fed a whole lot of people with a whole lot of nothing and came up with a whole lot of extra. And you could sit all day and talk, well, if this one's not with that one and that, well, then I'm not going to believe it. And you've missed the entire purpose why both of those passages were written. And we can get into the doctrinal aspects of all of that and talk about whether or not that actually matters. But when it comes to the Bible being an authority, things like that don't shake me. Things like that don't bother me. I am convinced this is the perfect Word of God. This here, right here. I don't need it any other way. I don't need anybody to retranslate it. I don't need anybody. I've been so vexed. You know how they have a pirate Bible? Yeah, it's ridiculous. It's written in pirate language, like you're an old-timey Hollywood pirate. They rewrote the whole Bible to make it sound like you're from Disneyland on a pirate ship. It's ridiculous. I heard of another one this past week. It's called the Queen James Bible. And they took the King James Bible and they twisted it completely. You're laughing. But they twisted it completely to have a very overt LGBTQRSTUV agenda. The Queen James Bible. Boy, I'd be careful with that. I'd be careful with that. This book has been preserved for us through the centuries. And Baptists specifically believe that the Bible, and only the Bible, is the source of what we believe in our hearts and how we live our lives. And the Bible, as our final and only authority, is important because it protects us from false teachings. It's very easy to take something that someone says or preaches or thinks and compare it to what this book says to determine whether or not it is accurate or the truth. If we don't have a foundation of truth to move forward with, we cannot trust anything. And I've told you, if this book isn't 100% true, backwards and forwards, I'm going to throw it out and I'm quitting. Because if I don't have this book to stand on, I have nothing else. I don't have that much faith. And I'm glad I don't have to, because God has promised me some things from his book. This is just an introduction. Don't worry, we're going to actually read it in just a moment. If we were to rely on other sources, such as traditions or human reasoning or just the teachings of men, we would be prone to error, and it would be very easy for us to be led astray, but we don't have to worry about that. Let's take a look here at Psalm chapter 19. Look at verse number 7. Psalm 19:7. This is what the Word of God says about itself. The law of the Lord is, say that word with me, perfect. I love that word. I like when things are perfect. I told you about Liam saying that the other day. Perfect. If it can be perfect, I want it to be perfect. That's just my personality. That's my aesthetic. I work on graphic design stuff. My wife asked me today, I'm working on a new project for somebody. And she said, did you send that out yet? I said, nope, it's just not right where I want it yet. It needs to be perfect for me to send it out. I have that kind of scrutiny when it comes to the Word of God. I'm glad that it tells me it's perfect. The law of the Lord is perfect. How do we know that? Converting the soul. Things happen. God's word makes things happen in the heart of man. He is converted from his sin, converted it from his past transgressions. He says the testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. There's that wisdom again from the Word of God, making wise the simple. He says the statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. This is what God's word has to say about itself. Now, I'm going to run you through half a dozen or more verses here before we get into our actual message for tonight. I want to take a look at these verses and read about what the Word of God says. I've put these in chronological order as far as where they appear in the Bible. So let's go to Psalm 138. Psalm 138. And we're just going to read each of these, and then we'll refer back to them throughout the message. Psalm 138 and verse number 2. Psalm 138 and verse 2. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. And so as we read this verse, what we find is that God has given us his name. And what a wonderful name. All the names of Christ, all the titles of Christ, just the fact that we know God's name tells us so much about our relationship with him and about what he offers to us and what he thinks of us as mankind. He gave us his name. But God has magnified his word above his name. And so we often will go around and talk about the name of God, the name of Jesus. And of course, it's the name of Jesus that every knee shall bow before and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. There's a name that's given above every other name that men must be saved by. But his word he has magnified above that. The word of God takes precedence, not just in our churches, but in the mind of God himself. He puts that much emphasis on it. Go with me to John chapter 17. Some of these will be familiar, but we're going to refer back to them, so I'd like to see them on paper. John 17. John chapter 17, verse 17. Sanctify them, this is Jesus praying to the Father, through thy truth. Thy word is truth. I'm glad that Jesus said that because he was praying to the Father. And so much of what Jesus said, he said, came from the Father. And if I can be assured that it is truth, I don't even have to think about it. If I can be assured that the word of God is truth and by it I will be sanctified, that's what I'm going to pay attention to. That's what I'm going to listen to. And some of the first questions I ask people when we get into theological debates or questions or whatever it may be, I begin with a couple very simple things. Do you believe in God? That's where we have to start. Because if a person does not believe that a God exists, there's no point in continuing a spiritual conversation. That must be the first thing they're convinced of. Secondly, if you do believe in God, do you believe that this book is his word? Because if we can't agree on that, we're going to have a whole lot more issues until we can come to terms on where we get our information about God. Because if you believe in God but don't believe that we have his word, then there's no point in trying to know him. There's no point in learning anything about him or trying to strive to be anything. But if this book is true, and if this book is his word, now we got something to talk about. Because there is a God in heaven and he has communicated to us. And therefore, we have some things that we must listen to. That's important. Thy word is truth. Acts chapter 17. Acts 17, verse number 11. We went over this verse not that long ago in our study in the book of Acts, and we find that there were some Christians that were saved in Thessalonica, and there were some Christians that were saved in Berea. And in Acts chapter 17, verse number 11, they are compared one to the other. And this was what they were compared on. It says, these in Berea were more noble than those in Thessalonica in that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. And this is a great characteristic of a Christian, is searching the scriptures daily to see whether or not these things be so. When you hear something on the news, search the scriptures. When you hear somebody tell you something about this world, about the future, about whatever, about mankind, search the scriptures. When you hear a preacher preach a message, that includes your own pastor, search the scriptures. When you've got a question, search the scriptures. When you have a problem, search the scriptures. And when you think you have something against God or what he said, especially then, search the scriptures, because it is our final authority. When someone comes to me and asks me a Bible question, I can give them my opinion, but I overwhelmingly need to give them what this book says. And so oftentimes my answer will not be, well, I think, or I was taught, or whatever. I say, the Bible says, will normally be in my answer, because you can't argue with what the Bible says. Now, how I interpret it and how I take it and how I apply it might change, but if I tell you what the Bible says, that's why very seldom we'll put something other than Scripture on our church sign. We'll announce different things and put up different messages that way for holidays or something. But for the most part, we just put Scripture up there. Now, we could come up with trite sayings and funny little things to make you think, but that's fine, but you can't argue with Scripture. I was reading the verse as I came in today. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. That implies so much that he must be sought out and that he won't be around forever and that you have the opportunity right now. You can't argue with that. That's Bible. That's why it's out there. Phoenix said, do you want me to put the quotation marks on there? I said, absolutely. I want folks to know we're not just coming up with this on our own. We're pulling it from somewhere. The source. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Go there with me. Boy, I might not even get to the message. We'll just get to the meat of it, and then we'll comment on it quickly. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I tell you, this book, it's strange to say, but this book is my favorite subject to preach because it transcends everything else. And I know everything I preach should come from the book, but I mean the subject of this book. And I'm fighting really hard not to go through a whole King James thing. I don't feel led to do it yet, but I want to really bad. I've been through so much of that teaching and training, and I love it, and history, and there's a reason I have this book right in front of me, and I just like to tie people in knots who think that they've got other things to say against it. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 13 says, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. The only place you can do that is in the Scriptures. You can't contrast and compare spiritual things with spiritual things if you're not reading a spiritual book. You can contrast your thoughts and your ideas with other people's. You can contrast your own feelings and emotions with whatever it is you choose. But if you're not looking at it in the perfect law of liberty, you are not getting spiritual things with spiritual. 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And verse number 16, a verse we quote often when we talk about the Word of God. 2 Timothy 3, verse 16, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect. There's that word again, throughly furnished unto all good works. Every stitch of this book has been given by inspiration of God. There is no pointless chapter in it. There is not a single verse that is out of place or out of context or does not need to be there. God has done this on purpose. And it was given to us for purposes, for reasons, for profitability, for doctrine, for reproof and correction, for instruction in righteousness. It's what we're reading in the book of Proverbs. Every single page has that to offer to you. And so if I can preach anything tonight, my only message to you is, are you reading it? Are you getting it in you? This book needs to be the thing we read the most. We went to a bookstore yesterday with the kids, and our whole family likes books, from Liam all the way up. And then just we love it. And we get in there and just book after book after book after book and everything you can think of, you know, to tantalize the mind and to take you far away or to learn about something. And, you know, I kind of was looking around, and it's a little bit smaller of a bookstore, but I was excited when I found a section that was tiny, kind of small, but they had some Bibles, and I thought, well, praise the Lord. And there was some other stuff in there that kind of made you scratch your head and go, huh, can we hide that somewhere? Can we make sure nobody buys that? But they had the Bible, and I thought, well, every good bookstore ought to. I'm not going to judge them on what they choose to put on their shelves. I wouldn't put it there, but hey, they had the truth, and what a blessing that was. Let's see. Let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. It's profitable in all. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And verse number 13. 1 Thessalonians 2:13. For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. And one of the first things that a person has to come to realization of to be saved is that the things we tell them are not the words of men. These are not just black words on white paper. This is not just our ideas or our feelings or our policy. This is God speaking to mankind. The word of God in Hebrews 4:12, the Bible says, is quick and powerful. It's important that we pay attention to it. And then 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 20. We'll finish up our reading portion here. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 20. Second Peter 1:20, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. Nobody was handed mysteries on the backside of a desert and expected to express them to the world. Verse 21, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. And if I ever do take you through a King James study, we'll find that there was not a stitch of this book that somebody just found or pieced together or brought up and said, no, this is scripture. God was very specific in the way that he handed down the Bible. And so our first point tonight is that the Bible is the sole and final authority. And the foundation for this makes us distinctive. The fact that we believe the Bible so strongly and the fact that we believe it in such a way makes us different than even other Bible-believing Christians, Baptists specifically. We've got some things that make us very, very distinct. And again, the Bible's not just a collection of stories. It's not advice, but it's the very word of God. And it is sufficient to provide us with everything that we need to know to live a life that is pleasing to God, as we read in 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we can rely on other sources to supplement that and to give us extra things, but each of those needs to be spawned from this book. And I've often said, if you're reading a book that doesn't drive you back to the book, you might want to toss that one out. If it doesn't constantly refer back to this book or point you back to this book or make you desire to go back and read this book. I read some books that I would not recommend to every Christian. I kind of get some different people's ideas. What I mean by that is false teaching. I'll go through and I'll read somebody's ideas, somebody's lectures on something, somebody's notes to get an understanding of how they understood it. And then I dive right back into the Bible and then tear it to pieces with what I read in this book. Not everybody can do that. But every book I read gets me to want to be back in this one. And we can spend a lot of time reading fiction and everything else, and there's time and a place for that. It's kindergarten. But after that, we need to be serious about spiritual things. And my kids all got books at the bookstore, and they've got books that they're going to be reading. You'll find them sitting around here and there with books. And I often ask them, hey, how much time do you spend in God's book today? You read your little stories, go off on your adventures. That's great, but hey, get in the book. You're never too young to read the Bible. Never too young. You're never too old to read the Bible either. But this view, as Baptists, it makes us distinctive because many mainstream denominations don't hold to the belief that the Bible is the sole and final authority. Let me give you a few examples. Roman Catholicism, it places equal authority on Scripture and church tradition. What the Bible says and what the Pope says and what the church fathers say are equal. They are even. And that's how it is on paper. In reality, it's like this. The Bible has less authority. The Pope can say literally whatever he wants, and they really can't do anything about it. Baptists believe and teach that we should carefully evaluate traditions and practices, considering Scripture, and emphasize the supremacy, however you want to read that word, say that word, of God's Word over human traditions. God's Word comes first. And if the traditions that we uphold to or that we hold to stand up to the Bible, then we continue them. And if they don't, we're going to have to really look at those very closely to determine whether or not we continue. Liberal Protestant churches, they put personal experience that's subjective to them on the same level or sometimes above the authority of Scripture. We as Baptists believe and teach that we should test personal experiences and feelings against the unchanging truth of Scripture. The things that we experience, the things that we feel need to be tried against God's Word. Our Bible tells us that our heart is wicked, it is desperately wicked, and it is corrupt, and no man can know it. Therefore, the things that happen here need to be double-checked here to make sure that they land here. We're in video archive now, so everybody understands that. If you're listening on SoundCloud, that's in our heart, checked with our Bible, then it lands in our head, and we know what we're talking about. By the way, YouTube randomly chooses what the picture will be for the video, and I think there's an algorithm that looks for action. So I'm going to do a couple of these poses to see if they come up as the thumbnails. I'll let you know. Moving on. The charismatic movement gives weight to modern-day prophecies and revelations right alongside Scripture. We as Baptists, however, we believe and teach that we need to filter prophecy and revelations through the lens of Scripture and rely on the sufficiency of God's Word for spiritual growth and guidance. There are too many churches today that just, I had a vision, I had a dream, this thing happened, that thing happened. And we find that in a lot of different religions as well. My grandfather, before he passed away, would tell me all kinds of accounts of Catholic people that had visions and experiences. And then it became doctrine because somebody ate too many Doritos before they went to bed and had a dream. And there was a 90-foot Mary, talked to a couple kids on the beach, and there's doctrine out of it now. That's not in this book. And if it's not in this book, then I don't care how real it felt. I don't care how much it moved you or changed you. But that modern-day prophecy can't stand up because it's not in the book. You see how we're kind of a little bit different? Sole authority. The United Church of Christ places a strong emphasis on personal experience as well, but also reasoning and social justice, things that we do as Christians need to make sense in the world. And then therefore, as society changes, Christianity will change right alongside of it. They don't consider the Bible to be the only authority, and it's not the only guide, but they also draw from insights from various other sources, many of their own theologians. And we as Baptists encourage individuals to engage in critical thinking based upon principles of Scripture and weigh their personal experiences against the backdrop of God's Word. What you experience and how you engage with the world, you got to double check it with this book and make sure we're doing it God's way. That's what makes us distinct. The Episcopal Church places an emphasis on Scripture, but also tradition and reason as sources of authority. While they recognize the Bible as important, they also consider tradition and human reason as valuable in interpreting and applying the teachings of Scripture. Therefore, they take what is in the Word of God, and if it doesn't make sense the way it's written, well, then we need to figure out how we can put that in a more practical term, how we can use that in the world around us. God's Word, secondly tonight, is valued and revered above all else by itself. Now, I mean that in two different ways. We as Bible-believing Baptists, the B in our Baptist distinctives, believe that the Bible is to be revered above everything else and by itself. However, the Bible itself also reveres itself in that way. There is a clear distinction made between the words of God and the words of man, even in the Word of God. The Thessalonian believers that we read about, they received the Word of God from Paul and his companions and recognized it as the Word of God and not just the mere words of another human being. We read that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. The prophecies and teachings in the Bible were not the result of human will or intervention, but were spoken by holy men of God under the guidance and inspiration of the Holy Spirit, as we read in 2 Peter. Paul distinguished the message that he and others proclaimed as being taught by the Holy Spirit. It wasn't Paul speaking the words, it was the Holy Spirit through Paul speaking the words. I try to put that in what I say often, that it's not necessarily Paul that's telling us this. It was from Paul's mouth, maybe Luke's pen, but the Holy Spirit is the one over thousands of years still speaking to us through this book. Yes, it's important. Paul acknowledged that the message did not originate from human wisdom, but demonstrates the divine source of the Word of God, being God. And to reject the Word of God is not merely disregarding human words. You can toss out any book you want, but if you disregard this book, you're going to find yourself in a world of trouble and probably an eternity of trouble. Ultimately, by rejecting God's Word, we reject God Himself. And God is gracious to us. He gives us the Holy Spirit that will lead us into all truth. And if someone is truly searching for God, they will be led to this book. The Bible is our guide in life. Without it, we would just basically be stumbling around in the dark and we would have nowhere to go. The Bible tells us that in Psalm 119. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. Very literally and spiritually, we would be stumbling around. Our beliefs as Baptists are grounded in the Bible, and we hold these beliefs because we believe that they are what God has revealed to us through his word. Not because someone else has experienced them and said they work. Not because someone else has said, well, this sounds really good and, you know, it'll make you sound smart. No, it's because God said it. I believe it. That settles it. Right? I trapped you. God said it. That settles it, whether you believe it or not. I believe I have a magnet that says that on it in my office. The Bible has been likened to a treasure map. And if that's the case, then we are like treasure hunters. And just as a map shows us where to find things, the Bible shows us the way to find eternal life and a relationship with God. And just as a treasure hunter would follow the map and not listen to someone else who claims to know where the treasure is, we should follow the Bible and not listen to any other teachings that do not agree with it. I've told you about my great uncle trying to get me to follow these men that he has followed in the truth that they have been given by God. And my response to him is always, well, I'll just look in the Bible and ask God to show it to me firsthand. And I read commentaries and I check other people's books and read it, but I'm constantly finding it back in this book because someone can say something good. Someone can say something that sounds good. I've heard snippets of messages. And at first glance or at first listen, you say, boy, that's sweet to the ear. That's tasty. I like that. That's a good thought. There's something there. And the more I think about it and the more I ponder it, I think to myself, that's not biblical. I'd love to preach flowery messages that I can print off of the internet and just, you know, give you all these things that sound good. But it's got to be right, and it's got to be truth, and therefore, we must follow it. Not what other people think. The Bible's our only guide to truth and the way to God, just as a treasure map is the only guide to the treasure. By studying the Bible and understanding the importance of biblical authority, we can live a life that is pleasing to God, which is first and foremost. The Bible will give us insight and information into all kinds of different things, but to please God needs to be our highest motive. That he might have the preeminence, and that our lives might be a conduit of glory back to God, that he might get the glory in all things, because he deserves it. And so, we are faithful to this distinctive, sometimes to our own detriment, sometimes to our own death. Folks have been asked to renounce their doctrine and asked to renounce their stance and hold to the Bible, and many have gone to the stake for that belief. But the Baptist distinctive of biblical authority means that Baptists believe the Bible is the most important and reliable source of truth and guidance for their faith and how they live. That's it in a sentence. This book is the most important. We believe that the Bible is inspired by God and has the final say in what we believe and how we should live. To a Baptist, the Bible is more important than any human tradition or any leaders in matters of faith, and they trust the Bible as the ultimate source of truth and do not rely on other things like human traditions or religious leaders. And we have a long history of that. But we might not have a future in it. There are too many Baptists today that are walking away from the Bible. They're walking away from the Bible authority. They're walking away from the version of the Bible that they believe to be true. And listen, if this isn't it, I need to know where it is. Too many of the Bible correctors and the Bible critics want to try to tell us that this book cannot be perfect, that it's not the King James only. I've never heard of anybody else that was an only. I've never heard of an NIV only. I've never heard of an NLT only. Our kids are going to a private Christian outfit school. And they use a different version of the Bible. So they're always coming home and we're comparing, well, what was said at school about it and what does the Bible say about it? And notice, not what did their Bible say, what does the school have to say about it? What does the Bible have to say about it? But we're learning, we're teaching them how to live amongst people that believe differently than you. And when they memorize a verse at school, they have to memorize it in the version that's at school. And then when they come home, they have to memorize it in the Bible. And so they've got to do twice the work. But they're learning how to have grace. They're learning. I'm teaching the next generation what it's going to be like. It was hard enough for my parents' generation to stand on the King James. It's hard enough for my generation to stand on the King James. I have no idea what it's going to be like for the next generation to stand on the King James. And aside from the version issue, to stand on the Bible as the sole authority. This world wants to tear it down. This world wants to tell you, no, you have to do it our way. You have to do it by our rules. And many times those rules contradict what the Word of God says. And so when it comes to this world and their mandates, when it comes to this world and their expectations and the language they want you to use and not use, just stick with the Bible. Stick with the Bible as your sole authority for everything, not just for what we do within these walls, but when we leave this place, when we have family time, when we go and we're out in the community and people interact with us, this book needs to be the foundation. When you sit down and talk to your kids about the things that go on in this world, or when you sit around and watch the news and determine whether or not something's going to affect you, this book needs to be the foundation. We need to recognize the infallibility of Scripture. It is this that enables us as Baptists to place our full trust in the teachings of this book. And we can be confident that the Bible provides us with an unwavering foundation of truth that will withstand the test of time. Folks have been standing on this book for millennia, and we can continue to do so. The world and even other of the brethren and false religions will try to tell you that that's not the case. But I tell you, this book can be trusted. We need to be committed to it. Committed not just to standing for it, but to the authority of this book. We need to be willing to allow it to guide our life and to allow our life to be conformed to the image of His Son. And this book, in word form, is the image of His Son. We need to conform ourselves to this book. May our lives be a testimony to the power and the authority of God's Word, and may we continually strive to live according to its teachings. When we do this, we will experience the abundant life that comes from walking in obedience to God's Word and become instruments of His grace and truth in a world that desperately needs it. Truth. Truth. And so, what makes us distinct as Baptists? Well, the way we look at that book is first and foremost, Bible authority. That's your B in our Baptist distinctives. Let's pray. Father, we love You.